now coming to the Venus anatomies. So here you can see that this is a MIP image of your TOF veno sequence. And this is something for our residents. They are always asked to draw this kind of diagram in their exams. So this is a sagittal projection, and you can see that the important venous sinuses, which we often identify, are these superior sagittal sinus. So it should be completely seen as hyper intense area. Then you have this area of torcula. When you see this, we have seen in the mid sagittal anatomy talk also, the area of vein of Galen, internal cerebral vein. The major tributaries here are the veins of prolat, that is easily seen. You have your inferior sagittal sinus somewhere here, but most of the time these are not identified on TOF sequences. So these are the important ones, and your vein of labae is inferior from the transverse sinus. So you can see the transverse sinus and sigmoid sinus better on this frontal projection reconstruction. Vein of prolat, superior sagittal sinus, transverse sinus, sigmoid sinus, continuing into IGB. One of the most common variants is hypoplasia of these transverse and sigmoid sinus, which is more commonly seen on the left side. But sometimes on TOF angio, it can be confusing, or TOF veno, it can be confusing, and you may think that this is thrombosed. That time you can go ahead and perform a post-contrast venogram, which will clear our doubts. And after the post-contrast venogram, immediately you can perform a 3D T1 weighted sequence post-contrast, which will be another sensitive way to identify any flow void in the venous channels and identify the thrombosis. So another graphical depiction, superior sagittal, inferior sagittal, vein of prolat, vein of labae, cavernous sinus. So we'll see that in detail. So this is your cavernous sinus, and we have to understand the drainage of cavernous sinus, the tributaries which are draining into and from the cavernous sinus. So this is an area which can lead to a lot of important pathologies, and then their symptoms will be related to all these cranial nerves which are crossing the cavernous sinus. So that is located on either side of the pituitary fossa that we all know and body of the sphenoid bone. So unlike other dural venous sinuses, it is divided by multiple fibrous septae into small cave-like structures. So that is why it is called as the cavernous sinus. So the vascular connections where it receives its blood from are inferior and superior ophthalmic veins. So if there is cavernous sinus thrombosis, and the thrombus may extend into the ophthalmic veins, but there will be areas of ophthalmic congestion and swelling. As we know, in cases of even the Tolosa-Hunt syndrome, there can be cavernous sinus thrombosis associated, and then superior ophthalmic vein involvement. Drainage of the cavernous sinus is into the superior petrosal sinus and then to the transverse sinus, via the inferior petrosal sinus directly into the jugular bulb. So we cannot remember each of these points, but at least the important things we should try and remember. These are little easier diagrams to draw in your exam if you are a resident. So you are asked the drainage of cavernous sinus. So here you can see how it is connected to various other sinuses and venous channels. Superior orbital fissure and the inferior ophthalmic vein coming into the cavernous sinus. And then the cavernous sinus getting ahead and draining into the major sinuses. Normal variance in the venous channels and dural venous sinuses is something which is very, very common. And there are articles people have published using like over 1,000 patients whom they have scanned for various purposes. So most of the time it is left-sided hypoplastic transverse sinus, left-sided atretic transverse sinus, right-sided hypoplastic after that, sigmoid sinus again, hypoplasias are known. So that is one thing. Another is there are a lot of variants. So if you see your MIP image and you find that something is funny, something is odd, not as usual, just go back and search for the variants and you might find your diagnosis. So these are another graphical examples of various kinds of connections the dural venous sinuses can have. This is one important spotter question. This is occipital sinus, another variant of the venous sinus drainage. Arrhythmic granulations can sometimes mimic your intravenous sinus thrombosis. So that has to be carefully seen. So that's why I told you that only one sequence of veno is not sufficient. you might require post-contrast Vino, which is more sensitive. You have to correlate with your 3D flare sequence for loss of flow void. You have to correlate with your T2, whatever axial or coronal you have obtained. Post-contrast 3D T1 are really important because you can see these small arachnoid granulation clearly. Or if there is a thrombus, that also can be seen as a area which is non-enhancing. And even your gradient or swan images are important to pick up small areas of venous thrombosis. Only one fallacy is that sometimes the acute thrombus can be hyper intense on plain T1 only. So on post contrast T1, it will look as if there is complete contrast opacification. So that time you have to be careful, and you can compare with your pre-contrast T1. So once somebody asked in a conference to an expert that which sequence is the best to pick up venous sinus thrombosis, so that time also the answer was it has to be a combination of sequence. Sometimes it can be difficult with one. So yet another important aspect, arterial versus venous infarcts. So like there are arterial territories, there are venous territories. So when you see an area of infarct which is little odd, not fitting into your arterial territories, your angiogram looks normal and that area of infarct is showing a lot of hemorrhage within, you suspect that it is venous, not an arterial infarct. Then you can compare with these kind of graphics where they have depicted the areas of venous territories, and you can pick up which particular venous channel is likely to be thrombus. So this is a short table of difference. So this is not what we are discussing right now, but just revising venous infarct due to congestion, as we know. So there will be a lot of intralesional hemorrhages. They may revert, the edema may revert. Onset of symptoms is insidious. An angio is normal, Vino will show the finding. Arterial infarct will follow their own territories. They are ischemic in etiology. MR angio will pick up the arterial cutoffs. Reversibility will take time. Intralesional hemorrhages acutely are less common. So few more sets of images showing us the territory of venous drainage. So parasagittally, here you have your inferior sagittal sinus. The blue ones are for your internal cerebral veins. So another good spotter where you have bithalamic or areas of restricted diffusion with hemorrhage. So we'll see that with few examples, skipping this one. Just taking 2-3 important subsets of cases. So deep cerebral vein thrombosis is something which can be missed if you don't suspect it. On a plain CT scan, you can find out symmetric areas of hemorrhages which are there present in the areas of the thalamus, and that can be because of deep cerebral vein thrombosis. So internal cerebral vein thrombosis may be picked up as hyperdensities on your CT images, and MRI can show you clearly that there will be area of blooming on swan, edematous thalami, hemorrhage and infarcts. And thereafter, when you perform a good quality venogram and post contrast even, can pick up these thrombosis. So cavernous sinus thrombosis is another important entity to diagnose, and here you have to see thin sections from the cavernous sinus taken in coronal plane. They have to be T1 stir and post contrast even, and then you see asymmetric distension of the cavernous sinus with non-enhancing areas within. So nowadays, with the short epidemic of mucormycosis, we saw a lot of cases with enhancing and then non-enhancing tissues in the orbital apex and invasion of the cavernous sinus. Superior ophthalmic vein thrombosis, peripherally enhancing distended ophthalmic veins with non-enhancing areas within. Cortical venous thrombosis may be missed easily if you just see your top Vino. So you have to carefully see your 3D swan sequences where you are going to find cortical areas of blooming going along the cortical vessels, and patient might have chronic headache. So this is something which might be missed only if you see the venograms. So to summarize, what is important is anatomy is something which requires revision, and there are a lot of variations in the anatomy which may create confusion sometimes. So we can always refer to our resources and references, and also look at the source images whenever possible for angiograms and venograms.